All right, we are in action here. We've shifted cameras, shifted fields, still in Ballarat. Temperature dropping by the second at a frigid 9.7 degrees at the moment. Wind coming in at gusts of up to 44 kilometers an hour, 9 knots. It's been a chilly day. The night is no different to situation. We join the game where Queensland, mostly Brisbane's mammoth, is now up 2-1 against the aging masters, the Wombats, the representative team getting ready for their trip to WGC in London. Al Don with the disc, centers to Mike Baker. Lefty wearing 50, rips it. He's got his man. Other end of the field, 5 meters out. Looking for a dump, he finds Al Don for that. Al has Fatty, these two have played together for years up in Queensland against a lot of these mammoth opponents of theirs right now. Leon McIntyre, otherwise known as Fatty, throws for goal, has Mike Baker. 2-0, knotted up under the lights here.
Opponents of theirs right now. Leon McIntyre, otherwise known as Fatty, throws for goal, has Mike Baker. 2-0.
Max Halden, the captain and founder of the Bench Club that is now fighting under the name Clench. Maxie, welcome aboard to the broadcasting booth tonight. How's your day been so far?
Yeah, wonderful day. Thank you, Stefan. It's nice to be back with you. I feel like we've commentated precious few games together, but they've really been magical moments. Yeah, we did good today. Two wins, one loss to Colony, but yeah, hoping to maybe face them again later on in the tournament.
Regional adversaries. I heard you've taken a scalp, and to take one on the Colony Club is quite an accomplishment in itself there, Max. So we wish you the best, but a lot of people have been talking a lot of news about the Clench boys coming into this conversation. We're now watching this game and talking about it live, Ulti TV, coming to you through Sky Magazine as Abra Garfield jacks it to John McNaughton. He's got it, dumps to Reese Stewart. Reese Stewart surveying options, fake scuba. The disc comes out, surely a strip, non-contested, but the crowd is going to make you wear that one no matter what. Max, what do you know about this game here? The old boy Wombats versus the Mammoth Club from Queensland. What do you like? Who do you know? What's your take?
Look, I mean, Mammoth, young club, and I feel like the Wombats have lost to a few young clubs as Mammoth moved the disc to the sideline. And I actually don't mind cramming in the occasional cram hole, although they do like a bit push through. Flick to the... Oh, I cannot find that front corner. The wind is a bit of a crosswind this evening, being pushing the disc towards that sideline, and a few we've seen mishit, unfortunately. But you don't want to see the Wombats lose to another young team, Steph. It's been a few games this season where they just haven't been able to, you know, really outrun a team, and their wiles have not been enough.
We're going to need them to have their wiles on. They do have some legs. They do have some height and some springs on that roster, but it's got to be a tough task. George Salisbury reads it, but I think that's Chris Brown who gets his hand in the way, keeps it from completion. Mammoth setting up. Abra Garfield wants the disc, flanked by Troy Booth. A story in himself, Troy Booth, a member of the Wombats Club, who made a statement at the start that he would play Wombats, but that he insisted to play with this Mammoth Club for Nationals. Abra, high release backhand. It's floating. He's got Linus for the goal. No, that is Chris Brown. Called not in. Discussion. We've got game advisors coming onto the field. Advice is being sought. And still not in, and gets the easy one. I think that's Bainey gets the goal, is it? Oh, lock. All We've thrown the mic down to our game advisor. So, Chris Brown's disc on the goal line again. John McNaughton cuts for him. He wants it right away. Doesn't get the space and the isolation. Now Reese Stewart gets it to J-Mac for the goal. Mammoth up 3-2 over the Wombats. So, we're live here. We've got our viewership in between points here, Max. Tell us about Ballarat, the Rat, your thoughts on this city and the venues. Tell us how your team's been going and enjoying the city so far.
Ballarat is a beautiful regional centre in country Victoria, in the south of Australia. It is the hometown of a few famous Ultimate players, maybe none more famous than Dan Rule, current coach of the Australian representative men's team, the Dingoes. And he has a lot of fond memories of this beautiful city, and I feel, being connected to him, I feel connected to the city itself. So it's quite nice. I was here many years ago, but it's nice to be back. It is effing cold. I will say that. Somebody compared it to, it's un-Australianly cold, I would say. It's like being back in a different time, different place. All I'll say is it's been a bit difficult to adjust as a Sydney team to this weather. And if it's going to be hard for anyone, it's going to be hard for these Mammoth boys this evening because they're used to beautiful, sunny Brisbane where the weather is always perfect, if not a little bit too hot. All right, so we're waiting for another pull, a little bit of time between. Oh, Bainey with quite a zinger of a pull, really wanted to get it upwind. That's Wombats will let it roll a little bit back to the middle. A bit of a pull disruption play to start. They do okay. Grimmond on the mark there. Lots of space. Baker moving around with it. Moves it up the line. Oh, and the jack comes off straight away. It's well shaped. It couldn't quite pull it off. Oh, there's been another foul call.
Straight away.
Currently discussing it amongst it's themselves. They've got an uncontested foul, the observers see. Looks like. Oh, isolated man in the end zone. Will they hit him straight away? Very simple. Easy, simple, folksy, to Aldon pull point. That makes it 3-3.
Hey, cracker of a game here, all knotted up. The Wombats, Australia's Masters representative team. These guys, I'm good. The Wombats in Japan in 2012, silver medalists. Australia's equal with the Mundies as Australia's best finishers there. The hopes are certainly set high because of that campaign. They've got themselves a good team. It will be very different from the team 4 years ago. A lot of these members returning, but a lot of the big members from that team's on different rep teams. Most notably, Tom Rigaki, who was a big part of that Wombats team, is playing mixed this year, which puts that Mundy's team in very good nick to be what I think one of the better finishers over in London. But obviously, our hope here is for all of these Aussie rep teams to be taking names over there and, bringing home some medals. Luke Stevens puts a pull up. Ruben Berg clasps his hands. I think it's Simon Wood on the other side. Troy Booth collects, gets to Abra straight away. Abra breaks with his lefty to Seb. Seb Brown back to Bra. Abra gets it out to John McNaughton. J-Mac, as he's known, wearing his Firestorm hat, gets it to Boothie. Back to Reese Stewart. otherwise known as Junior from his days of young representative Ultimate. Junior flicks that lots of room all day to Chris Brown. The brothers Brown out there. Now Abra wants it with a demanding super dump cut to Booth, center of the field at the opposing brick mark. Backhand out to J-Mac, but too far in front. And the Wombats get a gimme of a turn. Hobbit picks up the disc. Ooh, had Junker going up line, but he decided to stay put. Now gets it to Junker on a super dump. Junker back to Warris. Now sends it to Jules. Now Stu Austin, otherwise known as Tex, as I've been hearing, Austin, Texas. Luke Stevens. And the big fella puts it deep. He's got a man. He's got himself a goal. Wombats, their experience leads them to a lead-taking goal. Great shot, great wheels to get under it. 4-3 for the old fellas.
I mean, that's got them fired up. You don't often see that from a Masters team, that kind of running on the field, that raw excitement. That's something you would more associate with a youthful team.
That youthful exuberance, of course. There may maybe these glimpses of glory that they're getting are bringing back their youthfulness and vitality. And let's hope it just continues to show like this, Max, for the duration.
I absolutely agree. And this Wombats team is exciting because, as you say, they do have some new faces. A lot of people who, I mean, I was frankly surprised even fit into the age division. I mean, I think we're going to have to check passports on the way in, to be frank. But there is a lot of youthful exuberance underneath the shell of the Masters this year, which is an exciting new dimension, I think.
Indeed it is. You've got that figured out well there, Maxie. And I still think that Mammoth aren't ready to turn over for him. And this is going to be a game. But the odds would be in Mammoth's favor from the get-go. So really, the longer the Wombats can stay in this is as much of a testament to their play as possible. And you know, if they can be in it at the end of this game and have a chance to win it, then they've stolen one from these young boys.
Very good call. Paul goes up. Looks strong. And will... looks like it's going to be caught, and it is deep in the end zone. They got three scuds coming down. Bit of a junky setup to start with, but Mammoth moves it pretty freely. That is an absolute classic crossfield hammer, and the jack. Oh, it's just sat perfectly, and the flick of the line has it. It looks as though they're signaling goal. It's a goal. That was just popping the corks all over the place. Three spectacular passes to wow, that's that'll silence the Wombats a little bit. Now
4-3, a screamer and a John McDonald's hands to kind of start that course of hucking.
And the jack, it's just set.
J-Mac is certainly known for his throws. Since Chris Burwell has effectively stepped out of the competitive Ultimate scene, I think it's a hands-down J-Mac. He's the best thrower in Queensland now, but always has been in that conversation for years. His throws, his lefty throws are sensational, and that hammer was just a little bit of a display of what he's capable of when he's got some room and some available targets. So... tie game, 4-4. Tim McLean's wearing a... wow, and we had Ginny, a player undressed on the Mammoth roster, thinking he could get to the other sideline while the pole went up. And Fatty just grabs that at his knee very casually with that left hand of his. Cross the field, Al Don fakes the big. Sends it back to J.D. John Damiani, the legend out of Perth. Wasn't sure John Damiani was going to be playing this Nationals. I thought his role was going to be coaching Sublime alone. He had effectively retired after playing 23 consecutive Nationals. He took last year off only to rejoin the ranks, it seems. He just can't give it up. Leon McIntyre, Fatty, gets it to Judah. JD, number two. on his back, but number one in your hearts. Al Don now with the disc. Mike Baker. A lot of Chili members on this team. They're probably the team most decimated by this Wombats representative roster. Fatty again. The patience of this Masters squad against a zone is something you would expect, I guess. Their effectiveness and ability to get it upfield is where we're going to need to see their athleticism. Carlos Gross does the Bruce Springsteen slide and gets himself a nice catch. I think Carlos was the reason the Wombats are wearing tank tops, and he is maybe one of the very few who has the guns out tonight. Him and JD, of course. The gun show with the tank tops, obviously a big part of the image and the intimidation. As Fatty moves it up the line to JD, a long point, Folksy. I think he made a little bit of a chicane in his cut to get that one. Fatty with the disc. Lefty, safe as houses. JD catches it above the head. Baker, Folksy. Great fluid movement out of this offense right now. Al Don. Fatty McIntyre at just about at the opposing brick mark, 20 meters out. Al Don, Mammoth maintain the zone. Good persistence on the zone and great flow and steadiness against it by the offense. A beautiful high release backhand from that left hand. It always just looks prettier out of a lefty. Now JD's shot for the end zone, but he shot a little early there. And Bainey got the easy turn. Now Locke Bonnie with the disc back to Baines. Baines to Timicals. Timicals jacks it. He's got a man. It's just beyond him, though. Well, Max, we've had two turnovers on this point so far. What do you see happening on this Wombats turnover?
Well, I mean, looks like Mammoth are going to surely set it up again. It's very effective. As you say, the patience is one of the strengths of the Wombats team. But you're baiting those over-the-top options, and sometimes they're just not going to come up. Even Dizza, as great a handle as there is just going to struggle to get him 100% of the time. Force more passes, get more turns. Simple as that. Oh, again, down by the knees, below the knees, moving it across the field. A little bit of vision impairment here, right on the sideline. Folksy, one of my favorite poppers in Australian Ultimate, and that is why. Piercing pass through the middle. Big fake. Crowd loves that one. Moves back across to Dizza. He won't be worried about that. Oh, moving up the field. Looks like Mammoth losing it a little bit, and that is going to be a short man against two tallies. Oh, a lot of contact on that D. And looks like there will be a call on the play. Yeah, Carlos, Lockmurph, Sam McGuckin, combined age, probably below Carlos's.
Two of the young up-and-coming big men in Queensland Ultimate. The Guck, as he's now known, I understand. And the call retracted. Classy move by the Dominican, Carlos. Luke Baines jogs to the disc. And they're going to give it one more try here. You mentioned Folksy's popping there, Max, and I couldn't help but compare him to you in that sense. As soon as you said it, I realized that there would be a strong similarity in your game and his, not just in your strengths and popping. We've got a shot. It's gone deep. Alex Leisk reads it, but the defense is there. Hands up immediately. I think he's got a case. The crowd will never like it. The crowd wants clean catches, but I do think he's got a case on that. Max, what was your perspective? Did you see enough contact for that foul?
Yeah, tough one on the no eyes that I have. But they are going to discuss it in detail. A tough one, again, I feel like the Wombats player had maybe the better position, but did make contact on the way through. So, I mean, you've got to make it clean if you want to get a D, so...
All a bit of a mess by the sounds of our replay. So anybody's call out there, whoever's probably feels the strongest about their perspective is the one who usually ends up getting these calls. But yeah, by my esteemed opinion, I think he had a validated reason for that call. There was just enough contact. Now it looks like people, we got some squatters out there. It sounds like this conversation's going, but they're sending it back to where it came from, which is a long way. That was a big huck. And I always like the would-be rule that missed hucks that go back on fouls have to be thrown again. All right, Max, bring us back into play here once all these players find their positions from dozens of seconds ago.
I mean, Bainey is an exciting throw. One of my, I really think Bainey has some of the best fakes in Australian Ultimate. And one of his real strengths is he will fake three times on the backhand side until he gets the option that he wants and still just put it pinpoint. He'll see the under here. And a little bit of flat movement. Grimmon grabs it. Oh, and a slip. Oh, the double movement in the air. Beautiful. Lovely lock Murphy. Oh, quick play. Tim McLeese with a big fake, but swings it back to the middle. Bainey in control again. Loves the high backhand. That's an absolute classic move. Timmy tries to get in with his fake. Swings it back to Bainey. Bainey will see the open option. Hits it without any trouble. And that is quite a beautiful goal in the end. Oh, the crowd is not happy, but Mammoth goes up. Oh, Mammoth ties the scores back again. 5-5.
Difficult to keep an Ultimate crowd happy, really, unless every throw is a hammer that is laid out for the catch or a full field.
Movement in the air. Beautiful.
We know how we like to
lovely
watch
lock
it. We know boring Ultimate is really the safest.
Quick play. Tim McLeese with a big fake and swings it back to the middle. Bainey in control again. Loves the high backhand. That's an
absolute classic move. Timmy tries to get in with his fake.
Swings it back to Bainey.
Free-flowing game to keep the crowd on your side.
And excuse my bad German pronunciation. But Schadenfreude definitely plays a big part in any crowd's enjoyment of a game. You want to see people succeed, and you want to see your friends succeed, but you also just want to see them fail a little bit. Just a tiny amount, just a few mistakes that really open up, you know, a whole world of banter that's going to be accessible after the game. So, I mean, success, yes, greatness, absolutely, but just a few, you know,
just a few reasons for us to point and laugh. Nothing with, you know, no hate involved, no vengeance, just a little bit of belly jiggling laughter at the expense of your friends.
I'm still thinking about that double movement layout to keep the disc alive by Lock Murphy. That was really beautiful play after after an unforced error, really. Ooh. Oh, yeah. All right, Wombat's bringing the disc back in. Fierce pivot back to the middle of the field. Looking for some options, finds one. Back on the sideline, showing a flick. Folksy makes a cut. It's going to be clear deep as he gets seen. Beautiful swing pass. Just sits exactly in the spot that he wants it. Throws it back, and it's very flat, and McGuckin gets way up to D it. He could have dunked that one. Mammoth slow to bring the disc back in, ready to set back up. Very disciplined team in this regard. Very few running guns that you'll see from them. Moves it to the middle of the field to Guckin. He'll be happy to move it quickly to the sideline. Oh, big fake from Alex. Is that Lock Murph? Oh, Elliot. Perfect. Pick called. Very useful whistle there. I mean, there's only so many ways you can yell, stop, please stop. The whistle really cuts through the noise.
We had a game, Bauhaus versus Rogue Resistance, where there would have been between 12 and 15 passes after an injury call that would surely, especially for the poor girl on the ground, would have liked that one to be resolved quicker. A whistle might have helped in that situation too.
Absolutely. Grimmon finds Lock Murph. Big open undercut here. Looked off, back to Grimmon. Oh, uncharacteristic drop there from Liam Grimmon. Crowd suggesting a lack of experience has contributed to that. Controversial statement, but I'm willing to repeat it on air. Retweet does not equal endorsement. Starting from the middle, very vertical stack, the most of the verticals. Move it backwards. Looking for a swing pass again. Using both sides of the field. That inside out. Beautiful bid from Grimmon, but it's not enough. It's way too late. And Wombats. That, from what looked like it could have been a 5-all situation, They've fived it all again.
Here's Al the Fatty, Leon McIntyre. You see back to Al Don, and we're going to see Al put up the big OI flick here. Find his man, back corner. Oh, just over the outstretched arms. And that's Dave Kahn with the gold, ex-member of the Bench Ultimate Club. Now, how many incarnations of Bench have we have to get to clench, Max? Run us through your national campaigns by name, at least.
Yeah. This is our fifth year at Australian Nationals. We started as Bench, and we're not deliberately going to change our name, but then next year we called ourselves Dench. We moved then from Dench to French, from French back to, oh man, what if I forget the names of my teams? Were Perth, we were called
Stench?
No, Trench, no, we're Clench this year. Trench, we were Drench last year. Hard to remember, and back we are to clench this year, or back to seas basically. Easy movement through the middle. Wombat's throwing a little bit of a poachy look here. But maybe they've folded. Bit of movement here. It's a nice big undercut, which is seen. Stuck on the sideline. Good movement. They'll take the reverse meters to keep possession. J-Max got streaming to the end zone, but won't get it. Oh, very cheeky pass there, which they're happy with. Yeah, Abra, of course, always finding the tight angles and hitting them with aplomb. J-Max got the disc in his hands. Anything can happen. Shows a bit of a wide around. Oh, hits a beautiful shapely pass, which just sneaks in. Unbelievable catch. Great catch there. Here we go. You can see that again. Just cool as you like around in between two players, boxes them out, and grabs it above his head. Stunning. Just class. And you can tell that they've thrown that maybe 100,000 times before.
Yeah, Seb Brown's come a long, long way with his ultimate game, absolutely. I remember when I first met him, ran into him at an airport, in fact, on route to a tournament I was, and I think he was off on holidays. He's like, hey, I think I know you from Frisbee. And at the time, he was just getting into it. And the amount of improvement he's had from that day in the airport till now is exceptional. He's turned into a very solid handler on this team. His throws are safe, handy. He can throw the arounds, throw the breaks. And when he needs to, he can run upfield and catch a goal or two and keep his defenders honest. So, Max, let's talk tournament. Let's talk about the women's division first, and then we'll move back over to the open. Give me your opinion of your top four teams, let's say semifinalists, and one victor.
I've often thought about why the women's division is so unpredictable. I've always found that trying to make selections for who's going to get through in the women's division is always hard, and there always seems to be a three-way tie that just absolutely cucks up the middle of the pool. So this year is just as unpredictable as the last. Rogue, unsurprisingly, in an absolutely dominant position, I think, coming in. I'm excited to see what Chaos can bring out of WA. There are two WA teams this year, which makes it exciting. But yeah, we'll do more on predictions after this. Wombat's coming in. Beautiful undercut. Grimmon goes for the high hand block. Oh, and it's too easy on the open side. Beautiful shape. Alec Deslandis with a beautiful catch in the end zone there. Just absolutely classic ultimate. Here we go. Grimmon goes for a little bit of a jab here. Doesn't quite get it. And then just a little bit of shape, just enough to squeeze it past the defender. Alec, with composure, catches it on the back of the end zone.
We've just been joined by Tom Rigacki, longtime Chile member founder, a rep at many levels. Gak, this is your old club. You won a silver medal with the Wombats. What's different about this team? What do you like about this team? Tell us a bit about these Wombats.
Just got to make the comment first, Pat. If you look at that replay of Alec, it's an early season trade. You can see he's wearing chili shorts. I just sense that there's an early trade there. It's a strong symbol early. I'd happily welcome to the club, officially launched today. Very different mix here. There's a young crop, a lot of guys that haven't played Masters before. I hope they know. Masters is getting more and more competitive, as you know. Top teams are all, you know, it's no longer, you know, the older guys who can't make the other teams. There's some really solid players that could make it on a lot of the clubs. So this is a great warm-up playing the top Australian teams to, you know, play against the best in Australia who's at that standard of at Worlds, I think. So they're playing pretty well against the solid Mammoth team. So I don't think they love the wind Mammoth, so it's helping them conditions the Wombats. Played too much zone for my like as well, boys. The Wombats should eat up zone, so I'd like to see them go man a bit more.
We'll see if they take that on. For now, we're back in action. Mammoth with the disc. Those of you watching this game, we most certainly invite you to share us around on all your social networks, your Facebooks, your Twitters, your, you know, Snapchats, whatever it is possible to share this game on. Give it a share. It's a great game. We're knotted up at sixes. The old boys versus the young Queensland Beach Boys. Johnny Mack now with the disc. He's Barramundi there playing with Tommy in London as has thrown a beautiful lefty hammer over to Chris Branner Linus, who has indicated it's a goal.
It's a great point. It's interesting. George, Silent George, nearly got that block there, just club base. They know each other well, and he predicted it. The lefty, great inside out, almost got there. Didn't quite. I think is a Wombat as
Johnny
well.
Mack now with the disc.
Barramundi there playing with
we like a bit of controversy around here. We've already brought up the Troy Booth gate. I think it was part of his rider, his pre-commitment clause that he was definitely going to play with Mammoth. I had a good run with them last year. I think he was a selector and made himself emotionally invested enough in the club.
Yeah, I mean, you talk about Silent George looking like he was sniffing out a block there. I'm not entirely convinced he's not telekinetic. He speaks precious few words, but yet it always seems like he knows exactly what's on your mind.
It's like X-Men, you know. It's like he should be in a wheelchair, really. I'm saying that. I like the Masters. A couple of guns out there for Carlos and JD. He's a cabinet maker. He has a good pair of pipes there, I reckon, and he can throw a bit now. I'm hoping Mammoth come out a man. If they know it's good, it's 6-7 to Mammoth. They could take half here if they play good, tight man. It looks like they're matching up. There's a lot of talk there, but the other thing that surprised me, you got J-Mac on there, one of the best pulls. He must be marking a handler, because why wouldn't you give him the pull? It's not a bad effort, but it's a bit shorter. J-Mac would have had it in the back of the end zone. Spatty picks it up to Al. It's two very solid handlers. It's a little bit of just junky. They've got a deep, there's someone free. Flipper's got a couple of lefties. Flipper and Mike Baker will regenerate all day. Baker swings to JD. He wants to finish. No, very disciplined. Fatty swings back to Judah. Yeah. JD, they're moving it well, but they're not moving it upfield. That's the problem. Al's looking at a foul run on JD. Al trying to get J-Mac in a foul run. Good luck with that one, brother. There's JD. Mikey just generating. Him and Flipper of the engine room. They just stopped cutting for a minute. Al needs to get out the way because J-Mac's got him covered at the moment. They've got plenty of room around the disc. Flipper again. That was open to McLeese. Good shutdown. Handlers are very, very comfortable at the moment moving it around, but there's not much action upfield. And, could have been a block. Al's done well to get that. He's worked hard to get it and disciplined enough. Sometimes when you work that hard, you want to make a big throw, but he's done the discipline thing. Wombat's using a lot of break throws to generate. Now they got a continuation. Carlos clears the open side. There's a cut down the line. No, looked off. Mike Baker again. Good undercut. A lot of action going. Oh, and it's dropped. It's dropped from JD. Mammoth, pick it up straight away. J-Mac's got it. Up it goes. It's floaty. He won't get there, though. Defender, no. Didn't quite get there. Not enough legs. 1-on-1 in the end zone. He turns for the flick. Oh, it's dump reset. They've got on the line to take half here, Mammoth. They just got to be disciplined. There's an up the line. That's the worst throw. You never throw to a man running away from you into the end zone. Never, ever do that. Kids watching at home, there's your tip. Over to you, Max or Pat.
I'll jump in quickly for the duration of this point and let Maxie take us over into the next one. But like Tommy said there, a crucial error at the end of a great big big throw off J-Mac there. Great huck. Lock Murphy hauled it in. He did the right thing, reset it, and then unfortunately that reset just tried to pump it up the line.
Quick comment for viewers at home. Pat's hair is looking fantastic, by the way. Look, big Grizzly Adams looking hot, Pat.
Thanks very much. Also still single for those ladies listening, so give me a call. Check me out. I don't actually have a Twitter feed, but you'll be able to find me if you need to.
See, I have a question here. The midpoint timeout. I 100% am against it. I think it is unsuccessful 80% of the time if I was going to have to put a number on it. Just always just a shameful choice. Just lets your defense set up and just it's not good for anyone.
As I think the problem with that at the moment is they look tired, the Wombats. If you look at that long, Fatty chased, didn't have enough in him. I reckon this is purely old men wanting to recharge the batteries a little bit. So I'm thinking it's just purely a little bit of the older legs versus younger legs. But I'm with you, Max. I think, you know, get it going. Let's Mammoth. Will they come out of some sort of D? I hope they don't. They got the turn. But, yeah, this is a big point. Big point. This could really... The winner of this point, I'm going to make the call, will win the game.
Nice call. Nice call. The pace of this game could very much fall into the favor of Mammoth. I think if they start playing that man, I know the wind has dropped a little bit. They've got the legs. I think they've lulled the Wombats into a small lead, like a small lead over them. It's a tight game. I think if they put on the Jets now, play tight man, they'll be able to run the Wombats into the ground just a little bit. All right, Maxie, bring us back into play. We're just about ready to come out of the timeout.
Yes, whistle indicates that time is on again. Everyone's going to look fresh. Looks like they're trying to find men. A little bit of pointing, decision making, choices. Tim McLeese comes across to our closest sideline and they're setting up in a horror of the Wombats and Mammoth are going for the man. Looks like they're backing their players in at the moment. There's no one really guarding the unders. Bit of Grimmond and he picks the right man. Lot of space between the handlers and the cutters, but it's rewarded with a big undercut. Stuck with the disc a little bit. Oh, really concentrates and finds the man on a sideline now, but a confident handler. Oh, big around. No chat, but comes off fairly cleanly. Big undercut coming from Folksy. Oh, who's rewarded? Layout D is not successful. Oh, and a very quick movement across to the middle of the field, but no continuation. Alec finds his dump fairly easily. Big shots on, but that's looked off. Another beautiful break pass to Al Don, who sees the middle fairly easily. Another quick movement from Folksy. Static with the disc again. And around it goes to JD. He's been a little bit quiet in this particular run of play, but he's back. Looks off the under from Folksy, and a little bit of a backward step there. Decided to take meters away from himself. JD sets himself up. Contactful mark there from Goosey. Grimmin sets up a little bit further away. Oh, a little bit of a slip and slide there, but catches it. Folksy fakes a backhand, looking for a bit of JD. Goes all the way around. Stuck on the sideline. Bit more Folksy action. Won't look for the cross field. Another behind. Oh, and another little quick movement up the field. Will they go for it? Look it off again. Another handler reset coming imminently. Ooh, a bit tougher. Stuck on that sideline once again. Oh, but absolute confidence. He absolutely loves a spin move, Al Don. Loves it every time. Goes double 360, 720.
Al Don, one of the best barn dancers you'll ever meet. Not that time, though. And he's a long... Here we go. J-Mac picks up the disc, puts it up. It's floating. There's no one near Elliot Cook for the goal. A great little run and gun, Mammoth, because they made him work hard. Mammoth scores that as the Wombats really look a bit dejected there on the field. Thinking, what could have been? They worked hard. Here we go. Here's the replay. Puts it up. Carlos runs very, very hard, but just gave him too many meters to start with. And an easy, safe pair of hands to finish. Mammoth take the half, 8-6. And I'm going to hand over to Pats. We're back into the action here, guys. Thanks for putting up with the halftime ramble. Some hard-hitting questions there from Steph. I'm going to hand back over. 8-6, just by the way, for viewers at home, this is to go to the top pool. The winner of this joins Hoss in the top pool to cross over with Chile and Colony. So it's a very important game, means a lot. And Pat's over to you.
Thanks very much, boys. Both of you obviously feel free to hang around for the duration of this game. Some good banter at the half there, but just as long as we get ourselves some libations, we can keep this up and stay well refreshed. And we're underway here. Wombats put up the poll. We've had some Twitter questions wondering about the age of Tommy the Gak Ragaki, wondering if he's 50. And I think he replied saying, I'm still just in my 40s, or perhaps maybe 30s. I think Tommy is a late 30s, 38 or 39 is my guess. He's just left us for a moment, but we'll be back. We're getting word from the wise Shua Garfield that he's just turned 39, so he's still got 365 glorious days of his 30s remaining. Give or take a few. And I think that's Sheriff Ibrahim who puts it up, unfortunately, right off of Wars. Is that Abra's jacked it. Reese is not going to get there, though. About 2-3 meters out in front. And the Wombats will have another crack here. Max, take us through the Wombats' offense.
Yeah, I mean, we should remind viewers today, of course, this is the third game that these guys have been playing today. And a tough pull, as you can tell. This is the 2-3 game. This is the tightest one. They both had losses today. So you can see why the legs just aren't necessarily all the way underneath them. Beautiful double jink to get open there. Oh, and the movement, it's just well enough. Not quite in front. Oh, questionable pass, which absolutely worked. Stephen Austin, and then jacks it. That internal confidence. Oh, there will presumably be a discussion here. I mean, he wanted to jump over him in reverse, but it wasn't going to play out that way.
I think Troy would have had a play at that if he could have just put his eyes on his opponent for 1 second and made that leap without it. Here we have a replay. It was a falling defender. The Wombat player was falling. Troy running into him certainly didn't help him staying on his feet, and I can understand why he would think it was a foul. My opinion was that was pretty incidental. And, that's a very difficult call. Let's hope they're working something out there on the field.
I mean, yeah, it is always challenging when you're almost on the way down and you get forced there. That there's a few people deciding to add their voices to the choir. Bit of discussion, bit of mediation there. The advisors decide to set themselves off. Looks like we're going with contested. Going with a contested foul, sending it back up the field. Not too far, but enough. I mean, this could be a big point for the Wombats. You know, the Mammoth has come out on offense to start here, and if they can't get it in, then this ties the game right back up, makes you feel like you're in it. Sometimes the optics of the situation is more important than the reality. A little bit of chat. Everyone decides on their final location. Yep. Tex with the disc. Steve Austin, Austin, Texas. Doesn't repeat the feat. Dave Kahn with a big swaggle in the air. Looks at his dump. Oh, and finds him with confidence, but cannot quite hit. Ooh. All right, Mammoth's starting roughly even with the brick mark. Big fake, sells the defender, but he hits the dump pass. Open pass, gets a little bit of air with Linus. Linus showing a flick, doesn't want it, nods it off. Oh, lovely little quick handler movement. They don't discuss it, they just decide. Guckin leans back for a huck, but Troy Boothie rather. Leans back for a huck, doesn't want it. The hammer, what the people wanted. Lovely placement across the field, back in the middle of the disc. Forces him to get meters, decides against it. A little bit of movement. He's not looked to his dump yet. He's going to get a high count. Oh, and doesn't get his hands in the right position. Oh, beautiful, powerful throw across the field there. Set up opposite. Set themselves up again. Mammoth showing this patience, which they've actually, consistently done. J-Mac is isolated, but looked off. They're back. They're keeping them out. And that around penetrating. And that is a goal up win. That's a big one for Mammoth. They take the lead 9-6.
Like you said, that was a very big point. Either way, that goes to Mammoth, and or Wombats, rather. And they're right back in it. But now that Mammoth have got it, that's the biggest lead of the game. A three-point lead. See here, Abra taking the shot. J-Mac doing a bit of Bruce Springsteen there. Get down on one knee, and that actually falls into a bit of a layout completely.
Steph, I have a quick question for you. I mean, you're a veteran of Queensland Ultimate. You've played many years out there. It's your decided home state. I'd like to know a little bit of what you like about this new Mammoth team. Queensland's had a lot of permutations of teams. It's maybe a little bit of a small town Ultimate in the places like Brisbane. What's the new team look like, Parto?
So this team is a combination initially of we just wanted to meld the Queensland teams together. What was Slamtown? What was Firestorm? I was a big proponent of this all happening, to be honest. Myself and Chris Cunliffe were really the two forces that made it happen, and the two of us totally uninvolved by the time they're in their second year. But it was really Firestorm just wasn't doing what they wanted to do. I pointed fingers saying that there was a bit of swagger missing, something missing, a rebrand, new uniform, new culture, just starting afresh. And I think to that end, they've got something new. This is a different team than what Firestorm was. A few more players, a few younger players were more welcome to the club. They wanted to be a part of something new, and it really is a better representation of Queensland Ultimate than before. So to that end, I think this team's come a long way. I don't think they're quite as strong as last year, but I still think they're very capable of beating anybody they face in this tournament.
Back to the action for now. It's a great summary. Carlos on the undercut, swings at the fatty. He has a look long. He's still having a look long, but he takes the under. Folks, he's such the engine room. He's been really good. Great battle of him and Timocles. And here's his partner in crime, Mike Baker. Those two lefties that run all day. Looks back, easy dump, swing to JD. Solid looking around. They're very good at the recess. They're very patient, the Wombats. Mike Baker again making a generating cut. I'd like to see someone covering him under. Oh, stretched for it. It looked like he spent it before he had it. And up goes the huck. Fatty sees it late. And it's a goal. Oh, that's really unfortunate because they were working the disc well. They were really moving it side to side and just a little bit unlucky in the end.
Unlucky indeed. The Wombats have got to put it all together for a whole point. Here we see Elliot Cook put up the OI. He's got Fatty turned around, and Alex Leask has just got a few more knots of wheels closing down on that one.
I go back to one point before when you were talking about Slamtown and Firestorm. I mean, honestly, I get the refresh. Not much has changed, and it's partly your fault, Pats, because you and Chris, as you said, did it and then walked away. There's another guy which... The Beast would make a big difference here, and we know he's a great athlete overall, and he would be making a difference to this team if he chose to play. There's no doubt about it. He's shown that a number of occasions and pulled out of a number of campaigns. Breaks my heart to say it, but look, he's a wild Brumby. He's hard to tame, and unfortunately, I see though, is Slamtown a great Div 2 result, so good on him keeping together. Some great boys over there. But I got to say, back to the action here, Max, 10-6. This is a difficult situation. They've just got a bit of a two-point run both sides of half. Can you see the Wombats getting themselves out of it? Because they're moving the disc well, making some uncharacteristic mistakes. Do they need to start going for a little bit more? I'm not sure. What do you think?
Yeah, it's a tough one. And the one thing that the Mammoth has been doing very well is stopping the hugs by using a little bit of physicality on the mark very early in the count. Wombats feel like they haven't really had free flow to shoot those passes. When they're given space, someone like Al Don or JD can really find some nice flicks, but it's not happening for them at the moment. Mammoth bring back the zone again. The commentary booth has already decided this is not a good move, and we'll see if it pays off for them.
Well, it's proven dividends. They're not getting blocks with the zone, but they're getting turnovers, so it's a big difference. And, that's a late bid into his back. I hope he's all right. He's just getting up here. A little bit audacious at the back. We got the replay. He's caught the disc and he's just landing his back a bit, or his glutes. Clean grab.
I think they call that backpacking nowadays.
There is. You need a visa for that normally. I don't think he had the visa pass. He's hopping up, no injury. Old man Greenfield going across. Nice of you. Just give it a best. He would love to be out there, Greenfield. He would love to be.
Greeny tells him there's no way you're in anywhere near as much pain as I am on a day-to-day.
That's it. Now, Barry's a man that is almost 50. Dump to Al. Al looking to give go. No, he's... Oh, put the hark. That is very sharp. Downwind. You cannot put a blade, any edge on that downwind throw. You have to flow. And Mammoth's done that a few times. It would have actually just floated it. You cannot have an edge going downwind. The advantage of that is Mammoth have a slight into the wind situation. So if there's any positive out of that situation, they now have to go coast to coast. But look, let's see how we go. We've got some O-line on D-line. I always love this matchup. When you get the D-line, they're all athletic, but can they score? The O-line's got great throws. Ave, you got, you know, Judah Al have to work hard here. Here we go, faking. He doesn't look confident. See, this is the D-line. Just not sure. What do I do with it? There we go. Give it to another guy. It's his problem. No, it's my problem again. What do I do? There he goes, faking. He never looks like he's going to throw that, but they're getting it, and there's a bit of it. I'd call that a travel, but no, it's okay. He's just doing a poker dance. There it is. Nice up the line cut. No, he was never going to huck that. That was doing a good job. Giving up dumps. They have made about 10 metres with six throws, and that was not to the man. I'll make the call. That wasn't to Goose, but he did well to be there. They've got the swing. They've got the dump. Reset. Al on the mark. Not very strong. Chris Warris, great effort, and he's just done his back there. Oh, he's bounced. That is a spring that's just lost a bit of spring.
Oh, that was a definite old man injury. You saw him as soon as he hit the ground. He knew that he was pulling up lame.
Yeah, I spoke to Chris before, and Johnny gives me a thing. I said, how you been? He said, I'm pretty good. I've got a bit of shaggers back, but otherwise I'm all right.
Outstanding. All right. Double switch there. Goosey decides to check out, and J-Max on. This could be the added hands that they need here to really punch it in. All right, lots of space. Need to trust the handler movement. Baney gets it up the line. Oh, he'll want to advance the disc a little bit. Grimman. Oh, he loves that little high flick. A little bit of contact there on the mark, but all G. Up they go. Oh, he's going to milk it in. It looks good. Oh, an injury. You don't want that, but 11-6, nevertheless, that's a goal.
Yeah, look, just having a look there. I'm not sure about, I don't want that. We've got to play these two teams in our pool tomorrow. I want plenty of this, but it is just good, courageous ultimate, and he's a hard man to beat up the line, but goal side, just a couple of bids from behind, just trying hard. All the boys are trying hard, basically, but sometimes a bit from behind doesn't help. And Chris Warris, when you watch this back, mate, when you get to your age, those horizontal layout Ds look spectacular, but they hurt.
Yeah, let's just all be safe out there, you old boys. We don't need those physios working overtime for this tournament.
Now, you know me, Pats. I'm always interested in Frisbee fashion. I'm always seeing where it's going, and I'm always curious to see, you know, what's the next. A lot of teams that we've seen here at this tournament have matching tracksuit pants now. This is a new thing in Australian Ultimates. It's been Fuse from Brisbane have a beautiful new set. Colony was a trendsetter in this 2 years ago. Really beautiful stuff. And it's interesting to see so many players today with.
I think the tracksuit bottoms is what the tank tops were, the reversible tank tops were 2 years ago.
I'll tell you now, anyone listening at home, if someone plays against you in tracksuit pants, get really, really angry and smash them, because that means that they just don't care. They are warming up. They are not playing against you. And Goose has got a pair on. I just wish he was marking right now. But nothing makes you more angry than a guy playing against you in tracksuit. You do not see Djokovic playing against Federer. I want to take my tracksuit pair. It's too cold, Djokovic. I'm sorry.
The only thing worse is marking up against a player wearing sunglasses. But you're absolutely right. The track pants drive me nuts. My legs are cold. I've been wearing shorts all day, and I'm not even running. But we want to see your legs. We want to see your uniform. But if you're going to wear the pants, if you insist, I do suppose that these team-coordinated uniform pants might be the dawn of the uniform.
Yeah, they're stuck in their own zone, the Wombats, at the moment. There's a big swing. Well, they got no continuation. They all just flooded that open side for a bit. They're still in their own end zone. Callahan is on if they want it. But it's a little bit loose. They're giving that little throw here and there. Again, just been the story of the day. They're giving dumb swings all day, but they're not really advancing it. That's a good little fake. They're out of their own end zone. Hooray. It's only been 12 throws, but they're patient. I'll give them that much. There's nothing happening upfield. It's very stagnant. It's a little bit lack of. They need a good popper go, just going through and generating. They've got four around the disc, Mammoth. There's another break force, and there's a call. Looking to see what it is. Goose has made a call there, I think.
I mean, Goose is he's an experienced travel caller. He's done it many times in very important matches before. Halibut, for example. He's a storied history of travel calls.
I think Goose said, excuse me, I've got to take a time out to take my pants off. It's starting to get warm in this cup. No, it's back in. Fatty's got it. Unmarked. There's the swing. They really look, they've always got to get out a jail card. They've always got an open man, but they're doing well, Mammoth, at the moment to make that open man in a not dangerous position. So it's a bit of a battle of attrition. And so far what's happened at some point is Wombats have managed to throw it away or drop it or something. But here we go. Sort of 2-on-2 upfield and sort of 5-on-5. There's a bit of a chest bump. How do you do? What are you doing for dinner later tonight? Nothing. I'll get it back to you. They're really on this strong side. Now a little give go between Fatty and Al. Winds up. Here's our Kiwi import. Here we go. Up it goes. And it is short. And that was what it is. And when you force 20 or 30 throws, frustration builds. And that's Mammoth really, really relied on that. Hey, I'm just going to frustrate the hell out of you and make you throw something you don't want to.
And here's the throw again. Sheriff Ibrahim puts it up, but Locke Murphy had no problem. You still do probably want to catch that, but I think either way, that was never coming off.
This is an exciting new trend we've seen so far today. At least Clench has seen it. The not catching your Ds. I mean, it really sends a strong message to the other team that you do not care. I mean, you know, you're so confident in your D. And it feels great personally out of the hands. But of course, you know, you run a risk, but you're willing to run that risk. It's kind of that chicken situation where you're just going full speed. Oh, they want a big shot here. He's isolated deep. Look it off. Tim McLeese sees it back through the middle of the field. Back through safe hands to Leesk. Oh, sees a forward pass. It's wonderful layout. Really did all he could there, Guckin. But better in the air than horizontally, it would seem. Can't make miracles happen. Wombats start with the disc. Like they're going. They're back in man, Mammoth. On the sideline. Nice little flick there. There's not a lot of continuation happening upfield. Not a lot of options. Swings it back around. Still cramming it in the cram hole. Folksy with the disc on the sideline. Safe back to the middle. Strong cut there. Oh, and they decide to use the other side of the field. Why not? Oh, a hand block, but it's still in the air. Oh, indeed. Catch his own hand block. A rarity, but a beautiful thing. Timocles moves it quickly. Goosey swings it to the other sideline. Got a player in power position. Looks it off, swings it back to the middle. Pushes through. Again, the man poaching in the lane. Goosey, casual as you like. Oh, no. It's worked out for him, though. Not the intended receiver. Yes, exactly. It all comes through.
That was amazing. He found a man. It's the best no-look the world has ever seen, or that was unintentional. Wombats get another crack. They must win this, boys. They must win this. There's the hand block. Oh, we're just looking back. Brilliant. It's hard on the lefty, too. It's hard to get that on the lefty.
Those lefties they just wreak havoc against all of your defensive strategies, whether it just be as simple as holding forces or zones against them. The lefty just throws off the mark every time, makes it interesting. Always assuming the right-hand thrower as Fatty goes to Al. And Al goes to the dirt, but the Dominican sensation, Carlos Gross, picks it up on the turf. Sheriff looking now. Trying to engage his dump. He's looking for Fatty. Fatty's well covered. He's cracked it. Al Dawn had a step, but way too far out in front for him.
Looking at the Wombats boys, it just looks like they're disciplined. They want to do the right thing, but they don't have that get out of jail. You know, you got J-Mac, you got Brav, the big throw, you got Linus. You know, you got these guys that are just going to get you out of jail sometimes. Now, you don't want to rely on it, but when you need it, it's there. And Mammoth called timeout, Max. You won't be happy with this. Tell me about it.
I am absolutely livid. Again, did they not learn nothing from the previous point where they did not, they absolutely did not score off that timeout midpoint? 80% of these are turnovers. And, I mean, statistically, this one could be a score, but it's unlikely to be so. Just outrageous that it still happens in modern Ultimate. I thought it would be a thing that happened in the 80s or the 90s.
I've entertained a few conversations about the the stronghold or the staying power of this in-point timeout. I've heard a lot of people's opinions about there being no need for it. And it's really like to take a break on the offensive foot. Yeah, sure, there's long points in this game. We're playing 6-7 turnover points. But I think that's what turns this into the war of attrition that we all play this for. We want to see who can endure and last the longest. So in my opinion, if this was removed from the game, it would perhaps make it just even better of a game.
15 minutes to go in this game for viewers at home, so Wombats definitely need his point. But while we're talking controversy, just boys, any one of you, uniform, there'd be a few policy changes. You've got to have a logo, sleeves, so you're going to have to change yours, Max. Any strong viewpoints either way?
Well, look, all I'll say is there is an AGM coming up for AFTA, and there has been a policy put forward from one former Woofduff president, WFDF president, Jonathan Potts, who's putting his name in the ring. And I don't see this uniform policy continuing under a Pottsy rule. So who knows? Maybe we won't be under the yoke in 2017.
Well, Jonathan's a good friend of mine, and he's as close to Donald Trump as you get. And I do feel a bit of a double disillusion election coming up.
Yeah, Donald Trump without the hair maybe would be the main difference.
No, he's a good man. Let's hope he gets up because we need. He's got a lot of experience and we do need some strong leaders out there that are willing to commit to this sport. So thank you to all those administrators out there. Keep our leagues going, keep our associations running. But back to the serious stuff, people. There is, as I said, about 14 minutes to go. Mammoth's got the disc. If they win this point, they've probably got it. A big huck going up, but no, looks it off. They go dump. I never understand. A timeout to call a set play for a dump. That's interesting. Goose, little inside out. That's a good throw. Reese looks it up. Swing. Tim McLeese, best dressed man, is fake, and then looks in the open side. They're not getting breaks out. It's all open side at the moment. There's a call there. Just looking. Pick call from the look of the observers. They're just going to set it back here. Who's there with a disc, Steph?
Lachlan Bonney with the disc, a new member on the squad. I believe he even got called up mid-season for some of his strong play in training and with the Div 2 team that he started the season with.
Brilliant. Sharif from NZ marking up on him. Everyone looks pretty well matched up. And turnover. I just talked him up, and that's what happens. Commentator's curse. Sharif, give go with Carlos. He's got no mark on him. He's got Mike for the swing. Looks him off. Dumps it to Al instead. Up the line to Fatty. They keep going open side. They need to get to the other sideline. They just keep trying to stick it up the cram hole. Funny looking flick, but he's a lefty. Al does the little swan dance again. This time he throws it to him. He's got a swing to Alec. Looks that off. Flipper generating once again. Nothing there. Fatty, the break force lefty. Had a beard, didn't get it. Mike Baker's got the disc. Safe options normally. Has a look around. Good swing. Fatty, another lefty. They've got a lot of lefties, this Wombats team. Oh, he's done a fake. He made him look. I love it. And then flicks it underneath. Welcome to the game, rookie. Carlos has got it. Fakes up the line. Dump. He's dumping again. There he is, Fatty. Will he make a magic trick? No. Stock standard backhand. There's a cut across the line. Look, as a pick, and that's why it was not looked at. We're just going to stop for a minute. It's good defense. It's good offense. They're very disciplined, the Wombats team. But Mammoth is sticking to their guns as well. So everyone's, if you look at the Mammoth team, they're on their haunches at the moment, knees down, bent over. They're standing up now. We're about to get play back on. Mike Baker for disc. Looking. Alec generates a cut. Great work. Got the disc, faking a hammer. Up the line, two blade hitters. I think he wanted the air bounce there, Pats. I think he wanted the air bounce and just got too much edge on it. Here we go. No, this is the fake. Oh, look at that. Major look, haha.
Beautiful play by Fatty. Unlucky shot to the end zone by the Wombats. Tim McLeese now sets Mammoth the other way. Goose gets the disc. Far side to Finn. Finn's got it up to McGuckin. He's got a streaking receiver in Alex, but he opts to reset to his handler. Goose gets it to Locke Murph, one of the young up-and-coming big men in Queensland. Goose again gets it to Al Leisk. Leisk has a shot. He's got Locke Murphy on the goal line, on the doorstep. Right in the corner there. Meter out. slides it in there, crams it in the cram hole. McGuckin with the goal, 12-6. We're doubled up now, Tommy.
Yeah, big point. They had their chances there, the Wombats. If I look at that, and maybe it was because they were going into the wind and down the wind, and just look at the replay, picks it up. They're only at halfway at this point. Up goes the Huck. Just always leading edge, just solid. Now, at this point, there's a lot of room, but just worked around him. Just got around the back and actually snuck in. Like, I mean, it was a good huck, but that just the work ethic. But what I'm seeing at the moment, Mammoth stacking a lot deeper and getting the unders. They're stacking deeper. Wombats are getting it under as well, but not from as deep as the position. So their gainers are 3-4 metres. Mammoth are getting better gainers. Now, I don't know if this is starting to be... I don't want to sort of generalise or tag them as the age thing, because there's some great athletes on the Wombats. But at the moment, it looks like Mammoth's just a little bit more virile, a little bit more energetic, and they're stacking deeper and getting the unders with a threat, while the Wombats just hanging too close to the disc. They just need to lengthen the stack and get better, bigger gainers under.
As this game goes on, we see that difference in that that speed, that exuberance, and Mammoth. Every point, every further point we get in this game, we see the difference it's making a bit more. Maxi, we got J-Mac set to pull here. On a D-line, the old boys set to receive. Take us through this.
I mean, you want to see, you just for the game, you want to see the Wombats. Now this one, it's floating. It is a very, very questionable whether it comes in. Just bends backwards, sends it back to the bench.
Just I'll hand over to Max. I notice it's a very, some of the O-line players, a lot of the O-line players, they've switched the line here, Mammoth. I think they're just getting a bit cold, the Queenslanders, and it's a long point. So if you're giving the O-line a huck, and they actually look huddled up. If you look at Linus, a few of them are just huddled up going, I'm a bit cold, I need a run.
I'm surprised half of these guys even have jackets. But again, they bring the zone back a little bit. It's a three-man cut with a little bit of a short deep. Yeah, I reckon they'll try and fold it to man pretty soon, but we'll see when they do it. Moved it across. They've and there you go, they're in man again. Dave Khan with the disc on the sideline. Tries to find his dump, does a good job, sends the inside out. There's a call upfield. It's a pick. One of the classic tropes of Australian Ultimate.
Funny stack if you look on the screen, because you got JD there. You've got like a pool of fish and then one too deep, which is hurting them all back in. Now they're starting. A deeper stack, though, which I like. That's a better gainer. Continuation, but they're still just getting it down that same sideline. Herman looking, pivoting. Again, it's down the same sideline. They refuse to change the angle at the moment. They're starting to look. Is that Luke with the disc? Backhand up the line. No float again. And the problem there is they just kept trying to go down the open side. That's what teams want you to do. They want you to go down that side all the time. You need to change the angles sometimes.
Yeah, we call that one cramming it in the cram hole, and saw a cut was not there, unfortunately. Just a little bit of lack of vision behind a few Mammoth players, a few jinx look like a cut, and yeah, it's not worked out well. Mammoth picked the disc up. They've got to feel confident here. They're 12-6 up, and they've done it from this position before. Can the Wombats shut them out? A little bit of wily defense there in the middle of the stack, and then a swing across the field. Very open player. Folks, he gets on his man. Moved it across the disc. Oh, winds up for a big huck. But again, the discipline of the Mammoth team is really showing through here. J-Max got the disc and will absolutely punt it if required. Moves a nice little swing across. Puts a nice little backhand that Reese decides to look off for the moment. Moves it back to the middle. Got a totally poached player.
Troy Booth just ditched it. I played much disc golf with him, and I've seen that throw many a times. There's a little dishy over the top. Herman's got it. Another lefty from the Wombats. Will they get to the open side? He doesn't look confident. Nice little break in the end. Flipper has been such a rock. Him and Mike Baker keep generating, faking, pump fake. Someone go somewhere for me. Now they don't have a dump. Now, oh, there's the speculator. J-Mac reads it better than anyone. This could be a running gun. Herman's got a good mark. J-Mac, the big lefty. It's floating. This is a layout. Did not want it. The crowd was ready for it. Oh, jeez. That had a bit of float. It was not a bad option. You get it down the other side of the other side of the field. Wombats have to work it up again. Again, mentally, it's the fatigue versus the exuberance, but I would like to see Mammoth use it a bit more because they're... Oh, here we go. Now, when it lands within a metre of your foot, you should have a bid, I'd say.
Can you imagine? And if you have that on camera, I mean, that's just... That's your ultimate CV ready and written. Just ready to go, but, you know, he didn't see his future in that particular layout, unfortunately. I know. Folksy heads deep. There's a big Mike Baker in the end zone, but not seen. Folksy again generating through the middle, just doing God's work. Big backhand seam, cramming it absolutely in the cram hole. Big flick, looked off again. Discipline with the dump, keeps looking upfield. Oh, Folksy, just very uncharacteristic drop there from Folksy, which is unfortunate.
Yeah, they're taking their time here. This is the Mammoth O-line to some degree, so you'd think that they have a little bit of confidence. Oh, that's very casual. Troy made that look acrobatic. Here we go, Linus, good undercut. Solid, he's a big unit, Linus. Good pass, here he goes, open end zone. Swing into the middle to Reese. Reese continuation to Troy Booth, who's actually a wombat. He would have dropped that if he was cursed, but there's no Indian bookmakers in this game. 13-6 people with about 4 minutes to go. I think the story of the night has been good persistence from Mammoth. Here we go. Here's the swing to Reese. And look at this. Good. Troy read that a pass in advance. He's just jogging there. He's got jogging. He tells him he's got the biggest calves in Australia, Troy. Well, once maybe. Back in the day. Not anymore.
I'll take Booth on a calf off any day if we want to set that up. Maybe at the party Sunday night we can have ourselves a calf off Troy Booth when you're watching the replay of this.
This will be the last you hear of my dulcet tones. Any feedback is welcome via Mr. Max Halden on Twitter if you'd like. But obviously you're going to be in the capable hands of the mayor and Tom Ragacki.
Some feedback, Max. Make sure you get a shout in next time.
Good work, Maxie. Love to have you in the booth. We'll see you for next time. Okay, let's finish out this game here. As far as Mammoth's concerned, they want to make it a quick one at this stage by all intents and purposes. Wombats, you know, they want to chomp. They want to extend the game. They got to change it up. They got to get a few things falling their way. They're working hard. They're staying the patient game, but they're making it too difficult because the patient game is requiring 30, 40 throws to score, and they've got to take a few more strikes. They got to find a few more open spots and have some hot throws get there.
They do. And they need to stop trying to, you know, just get it up the strong side every time. They're just trying to get up the line. But here we go. They got a chance. Sharif swings it. It's a slightly different line. Fatty looking for Mike. He's made an open cut. Is it? They've just left a couple of handles wide open. They are wide open, and he's just sitting there looking. There's the swing, flipper over to. Again, they've had no deep cuts. They've really had no deep game today. They're just cutting from too deep. But here we go, Sharif. Again, around the disc, they're handling it well. Mike Baker, flipper, some familiar names. The thing is, at the moment is, this gets to this point, and there's a turnover, but not this time. Thanks for coming, he says. Great fake from Carlos, really good fake. Got him to go, and Al, he can do that, Al, sometimes. He just says, I'm going to get this goal, and here we go. Al decides to have a run. Let's look for where Al is at this point. He's just looking at it, and he's read that. He just read that early. Carlos, bomber, good fake, got him to go, clears up the backhand. Well done, Wombats, well done. And that was a change of direction, Pats. That was a change of direction. They approached it from a different angle. It makes a huge difference.
It's as though they heard us talking there, Tommy. See you again, Max Halden. As though they heard us talking, they were talking about their patient game being a little bit too conservative in that point. They still went sideline to sideline a few times, recycling the disc, but their gainers came. Their gainers came in the scoring half of the field. They got a big one up to Flipper, and then Flipper to Carlos really opened it up for Al to score. So a couple shots after some patience is what worked there, and hopefully they take note and show us a bit more of that.
It was. Well, if you look at the scores, 8-6 at half, that is their first point of the second half. They've had plenty of chances, but that is their actual first score. So we actually get a look at their D-line, and sometimes things can change up. I know I'm trying to create a bit of hope here with 5 minutes to go, or maybe 2 minutes. But, you know, it is different. All of a sudden, the O-line, teams these days tend to stick to O&D, which creates the opportunity for lots of runs, which means, you know, the O-line, you lose two or three in a row. As the Wombats struggled, you start to get in your head, and the D-line can get a bit of momentum. So into the wind, Mammoth. This is a good look to see. Other teams will look at this footage and go, what is Mammoth's A-game? And again, they've stacked deep and taken a lot of good options. Abra is their first option thrower. There goes the Hooter. Good undercut to Linus, who is way too open. No one's on him at all. Back to Abra, their gun thrower. So looks around, is distributing. It's just the Abra and Linus show at the moment. And he, Linus, takes a punt long to J-Mac, too bladey. Just, but you know what? That's what you want. You want your best receiver throwing your best thrower, not the other way around. So in a way, a good little result there. And that's what teams got to do. You know, when you're playing Colony, you want Mike Neal thrown to Mark Evans, not the other way around. That's the way that you want to play. It doesn't always work out that way.
That's it. Force these players out of their comfort zones. Make them prove that they're not one-dimensional. Make them prove that they can do it up both ends, from the hand or into the hand. And there, a good shot at it. The blade, the disc turned over on Linus and got a bit bladey. But I like that the Wombats put him into a situation to make that happen. Warris now with the disc in his own end zone. Marked tight by Abra. Nice little pop over top to Stewie Austin. Austin, Texas, as I've heard he's been called now. Now we got Luke Stevens, the captain of this defensive unit. Gets it across, pop back to Stevens. Stevens having a look. Moves it upfield. Good gainer there to Jules and straight back to Stevens. In a bit of a power position when he got it. Now a reset. Abra almost get a hand on that, but Georgie moves it. Shot to the end zone. Headman, the Colombian sensation. Wombats are back on the board, Tommy.
Booyah, that's what I'm talking about. A turn, the O-line doesn't want to chase, and the D-line, look, it's a long way to go, but here we go. Let's have another look at that. Jules, a great swing, a look from Brave. That is a reach, not a layout. A backhand should have been a forehand, but that will do. And then just a solid finish. That's a different angle, as we keep saying. They're using that a little bit smarter. And, you know, Mammoth would rather be in bed right now. They want a cup. They want a hot cup of soup. Maybe a frothy at some point. But, you know, they're going, oh, we've already won this game. No, they haven't. There's five. There's two more points to get, Mammoth. The Hooter's gone. Game two, actually, one more point. Game to 14 with the win this time. So they could finish it here.
Yeah, we were talking about this earlier in the day in one of our games. But a case of the wobbles. The team gets up. The team gets comfortable. The team has victory in their sights, and then the opponents just show a bit of life, and that it puts the doubt in the mind of the team above. Can we actually do this? Can we get to that finish line? And you most certainly have to. These are those situations where you got to score that last point. So I'm sure Mammoth are very capable, but it's situations like this that just plant a little seed of doubt in the minds of the team ahead.
Yeah, it wasn't a chilly game that you were watching, that's for sure. Bloody hell. About time you had the camera out of one of our games. Dominated today, apart from one bad half. But anyway, here we go. Wombats, Luke Stevens of the pull. It's a good one. That is going to land in. It's a little bit short, but it's north of the brick mark. And not caught. I don't understand why people don't catch that. It was coming in like a fairy. Here we go, Linus, another undercut. Here we go. Up it goes. They want to finish with a long cut. And it's gone. Great bid from the big fella. He has hurt himself. No, he's all right. For a big guy, I really do like the way Linus throws himself around. It is, you know, he actually got the dishy. Here we go. So if you think about it, he got that dishy earlier. And there he goes, turns Luke around. Just too edgy. Again, too edgy for a long throw. Outside in, you've got to give it float. As soon as it turns towards the pitcher side, it's gone. Not far. Great effort.
Yeah, Linus, one of the boxier big men in the Australian Ultimate Championships, this competition. He is a big, tall man, but doesn't necessarily fit the bill of the tall, lanky receiver. He's a big unit, and he still throws himself around, though, like he's going to hit the ground lightly every time.
Can we please have the Mark Isherwood versus Linus competition? Here we go. This is a bit more floaty. Oh, Joe! Wow. That's unfortunate. That was great leg speed. I don't know if he needed to lay in the end. He could have caught in his arms. He just sort of fell. That's a ground strip, my friends. That was a much more floaty throw. And here we go. Who's got the throw? Jules. That is how you throw people. Just a little bit more float. Give the receiver a chance. There's two of them there even. George, legs pumping. Here he comes. And that's on the chest. Just, I don't know if he needed to, Pats. I know, I love him, and he's a ripping guy, but just take an extra step, George.
Yeah, he's not going to be happy after watching that, especially in slow motion. You're right. He didn't need to lay, and the result, he got it with the lay, but that also caused the ground strip, so unfortunate for Georgie. Against his local compatriots here in Mammoth, he certainly wants to catch us. The best people to beat are your friends, so J-Mac with his gang of Merry Queenslanders moving back up with the disc. Linus, the big fella with the disc. Troy Booth now.
Oh, great. He's got it back. George, he's got that back with a great block. I was just watching Abra and Chris Warris having a great little tussle. Abra was absolutely running around, and Hobbit did not want to give him an inch at all. But Wombats, they do need this point, obviously, there. And there's a huck straight away. Jules doesn't want it this time. He's got the swing to Warris. He's got the further continuation. Now, the undercut's covered. Stu's on J-Mac. He's not sure where to go. Again, this is the Wombats. They're resetting the disc well, but there's no gainer. They're not cutting from deep. They're cutting deepest out. Here we go. Linus on Lukey. Linus on Lukey, and Linus just says, taking candy from a baby. There we go. Swings to J-Mac. He's got the disc. He's going to look long. He's got a Troy Booth, but he looks under instead. He's got Reese on the undercut. No mark at all. Swings it to Abra. He looks long, and he throws long. There's the game. No, it's way too long, Pats. And there's a bit of talk. Abra's blaming someone for that. I'm not sure who threw that out of your hand, brah, but I'd say that's your fault. Here we go. That's a good block from George. Just got on the inside there. Well done, Georgie. Well done. Got it back. Wombats with a disc. Oh, here we go. Linus with a right hand. Well done.
Just like we said earlier, that's a little bit of the big man, big man, the big shoulder, big man. Boxing out, and like you said, Tommy, taking candy from a baby there, it seemed. They both had similar position, but Linus used his forward step, and there was no way Luke Stevens was getting around that boxy body.
He would be a good rebounder in basketball. I'd like to have him in my team in the key, that's for sure. Hubble for disc, pivots. No, that's too far to throw a huck. Jules is back there. He's got a big wingspan. There's someone really open. Someone could have continued that. George looking for Stu. J-Mac looks upfield before he marks. Stu, good pivoting. He's a lefty. They got a lot of those. Throws it to Jules, and Jules had gone back under, unfortunately.
I really just liked watching Troy Booth lose his feet there. I love the man, but watching him fall like a little simpleton there just put a smile on my face.
Seen that drunk many a times, not sober. Abra has had another turn there, and he's again just looks like he's blaming someone else. He just needs to take some responsibility for his turns. Linus, though, went break force. Jules to pick up the disc. He's got Hobbit as a dump. It's a very deep stack, and the deepest is cutting away. That's the problem at the moment. They're in their own end zone, and their stack is spread from far and wide. It's a floater. Luke Linus, and Linus gets his hands to it. Does enough. It wasn't Tudo's pair, obviously, but they managed to get there. Who's picking up the disc? Reese, by the look of it. It looks for the dump cut first, fakes it. Up the line instead. Linus is really injecting himself on this point at the moment. Not known for his throws, and he's looking for a dump now, and that is well set up. Hammer to the end zone. Troy Booth, unconventional but effective.
Not known for his throws, as you said, but he does now have a good little arsenal of throws, as he shows there. The emergency hammer gets him a game-winning throw. A great game all around. Mammoth there. Youth and exuberance certainly overcame the experience, as we see Linus throw this game-winning hammer spot on to Troy Booth. It's been a great game, Tommy. Give us your final thoughts.
Yeah, good range from Linus. I never said he didn't have a range, just, you know, not known for it. Look, at the end of the day, it was a great first half. And look, the Mammoth guys just, I think I called it. If you watch the replay at 6-all or something, I said this is a big point, and it was. And they just came out in the second half. At the end of the day, I think he was a little bit of fatigue. The Wombats just tried to get too much on the open side and spread their stack too much. Mammoth just stacked deeper and took the unders a little bit more. Worked hard, Mammoth, for their victory, I must say. They'll be a little bit fatigued. It's late. They've got a backup tomorrow against the Colony team. So they'll be there. And more than likely, Chile facing them off for a very important game as well in the afternoon. Wombats go down a pool, but they're still alive, Pats. They will want to go deep in this tournament. They've got Worlds as their big prize. Yeah, they want to get to Worlds, of course, but they don't want to be playing off for second prize here. They want to go deep. They want to be at knockout stage, so they'll lick their wounds. They'll be back tomorrow.
Yeah, Yeah, tough pool. Three teams that definitely have a chance to get in. But a great game. Great first day at AUC here. I'm Steph Rapazzo. Thanks to Tom Rogacki and Max Halden for chiming in and broadcasting this game for Ulti TV through Skyd Magazine. Have a wonderful day. We'll see you tomorrow.